International consultancy Wood Mackenzie recently released a report on carbon pricing and upstream oil and gas production on the global scale. So we're going to talk to Graham Kellas, who's the Senior Vice President for Global Fiscal Research for Wood Mac. Welcome to the interview, Graham.
Hey, good morning. Thanks for having me.
Look, why don't we start with an overview of your study, please?
Okay, well, the study was basically initiated following discussions with some of our upstream oil and gas clients around the issue of carbon taxation or carbon cap and trading schemes, and how carbon charges may begin to become a feature in the upstream economics and the asset valuations. At the moment, they're very rare, but there is an expectation amongst investors that they are coming. The question is in what shape or form and at what rate, you know, what is the carbon price, very importantly. So we looked at the existing systems in place. As I say, there are very few. And then we also, by looking at the data that we have in our lens platform that covers all of the oil and gas assets around the world, we're able to look at the values of those and to calculate based on our emissions data that we have, what the possible impact on those asset values would be given a whole range of different carbon prices. And what it then taught us was that, you know, at low carbon prices, the impact mostly is fairly small. But as you increase the price, and Norway, for example, has recently announced that by 2030, it's going to have a carbon price somewhere in the region of $260 per ton. Canada, as you're very aware, is aiming towards 170, I think, Canadian dollars by 2030. These are much higher numbers than I think a lot of the investors are currently using. Something between 40 and 100, it tends to be the sort of assumptions that they're using. So when we look at those kind of numbers, the impact on the remaining value of the assets can be very, very significant indeed. But of course, there are mitigating factors in there which may help to reduce the actual overall impact on the asset values. And these are things like allowances, emission-free allowances, which can be awarded by governments under trading systems, allocating free credits, for example, or you know, potentially removing certain allowances from a tax system. And then the second thing that we were looking at was the ability to offset those new carbon charges against upstream taxation that you're already liable to. So if we take Norway as an example, it's the most mature area in terms of carbon taxation. They allow the carbon tax to be a deductible cost when it comes to calculating your petroleum income taxes. And that is, you know, at 78%, which is the tax rate in Norway, that's a significant deduction that you are able to do. So in other words, you know, if we think about $100 a ton, when you're getting 78% tax relief, then the net cost to you is more like sort of $20 per ton. There's all sorts of additional sort of nuances around that. No two fiscal systems in the world are the same. So the impact of these things is going to be very different depending on whether they're royalty based or whether they're tax based and so on. So a lot of different policy levers that are available for governments, and how they combine those and use those is obviously going to be something that will only unfold in time and is likely to be very different from one country to another.
Now, there's another variable in here that we haven't talked about, Graham, and Norway, bringing up Norway and Canada, I think illustrates this point very, and that is carbon intensity of oil. So in Alberta, in Canada, most of the oil is from the oil sands, and it has a very high carbon intensity, an average of 77 kilograms of CO2 equivalent per barrel, whereas in Norway, the average is 18 kilograms. And you have the Johan Sverdrup field, which is under one kilogram. And so if you have a high carbon price, but low carbon intensity, that that has a big impact in diluting the effect on production. So how important is carbon intensity of crude oil when calculating and doing your calculations?
Oh, extremely important. And you're absolutely right. I mean, the emissions data that we have, we use on for benchmarking purposes, and there is a very wide range, as you point out. The Canadian oil sands has very high emissions, probably something like double the global average. A new field development in Norway, Johan Sverdrup, is at the very bottom end because they have access to a grid that is fueled by renewable resources. So and they have been electrifying the offshore projects for some time now. And partly that would, I would say, be a result of the fact they've had a carbon tax applied to offshore operations since 1991. So there's a combination of things there. They have the infrastructure, if you like, onshore in place already, that they are renewable, they have a renewable power source. And then they have this additional incentive of changing the power requirements offshore to use that renewable source. And as I mentioned earlier as well, you get 78% tax relief on the costs that are included in that, which makes it, you know, which makes the net cost to the company much lower. And that's not going to be repeated in very many other situations. You know, all of those things, all of those boxes that Norway is able to tick may not be repeatable. Now, so in other countries, particularly where you've got asset, I mean, and in each country, I think you've got a range of emissions intensity on the assets. You know, some may be very low, others may be very high. So governments then have to decide how they're going to approach that. Is it a one size fits all that, you know, each emission is just charged the same carbon price? Or will they use a system of allowances, which may mean that, you know, older fields with older facilities and so on, which are emitting higher levels of carbon, they may be allowed to, you know, have some of that be exempt from the carbon prices. Again, all of these things are just going to have to be weighed into the overall policy.
Now, I'm going to ask you to look into your crystal ball a little bit, Graham, and I know this is an imperfect science, but, you know, there are some major producers like Russia, Saudi Arabia, and the United States, where it matters whether or not they do implement a carbon pricing. So what's your take on some of the bigger producers, like the countries I mentioned, putting in place a carbon price?
Well, yes, this is going to be really interesting. I mean, I think the US, the new administration there seems to be very much in favor of that. And of course, recently, the American Petroleum Institute lent its support to the concept, at least. But of course, the devil's going to be in the detail there. I think that, as I say, with companies looking at carbon prices of between $40 and $100 a ton in their assumptions when they're valuing upstream investments, that has one impact. If it's going to be like Norway and it's $250 a ton, then it's going to be quite different. And obviously the different types of operation, I think, you know, the onshore tight oil and Russian production is probably going to be towards the higher end of the emissions distribution. So the impact there is going to be quite significant. And another important point there is that both the US and Russia, well, particularly Russia, the government's share of the value, it comes more from royalty than it does from tax. The tax rates in those countries are relatively small, but the royalty rates can be actually quite significant. And you don't get to deduct any costs from the revenue for royalty purposes. So an additional carbon tax, unless they go about changing the actual rules of how they calculate the royalty, but the default would be that you won't get deductions from your income before the royalty is paid. So this is just a pure addition to the government's share of the income. As I say, in Norway, there's a bit more, you're displacing an existing tax with a new carbon tax. So there's a bit of a mitigating effect there, which isn't going to be so prominent in these royalty-based regimes, which what that might do then is to keep the carbon price applicable to be at lower levels than they might be in some other places.
Final question, Graham. And now you mentioned at the top of the interview that you started this study after talking to your oil and gas clients. What do your oil and gas clients think is the likelihood of more carbon pricing schemes being implemented and the likelihood of them becoming more stringent in the near to medium term?
Well, what we know is that they have been including some form of carbon pricing in their upstream investment models for some time now. So the overarching message we get is, look, we think it's a question of when, not if, these things are going to be applied. And I mean, the when might be, you know, many years in the future in some countries. In others, as we say, it started now. And I think a lot of countries will be looking at carbon pricing now, not just from the energy transition point of view, but also from a sort of, you know, we need to find money to boost the government coffers, you know, post-COVID and so on. There is a need for government to be paying back debt to help the economic recovery. It's got to get its money from somewhere. The oil price has risen quite a bit over the course of the past 12 months. So cash flow is beginning to be generated. Taxable income is beginning to be there. It may be seen that that's an area where, you know, if we introduce carbon taxes, then that gives us more money, not necessarily to spend on energy projects, but just basically for general recovery. So I think the feeling is that they're coming. It's just going to be a question of when and how much. And on the how much, again, that's going to be an interesting balancing act that I think governments are going to have to play, because the higher you go, the more it's going to put pressure on the investor, because the value of these projects is going to be less and less. Now, at some point, you're going to reach a tipping point where they basically say, look, you know, these carbon prices, I just can't afford this. You know, it's more than the value of the production. And do they close down operations? Do they not go ahead with new field developments? Of course, that has implications for the economy and the, you know, the oil supply balance. And different governments are going to have different views on that. Some will be saying, good, it's about time. It's time we started to close down our oil and gas sector because we're moving into a renewable world. For others, it's a big employer. They are still expecting the demand for oil and gas to be high for many years. So we might as well use our own resources rather than turning to importing them from elsewhere. So you're going to get different, I think you're going to get very different responses from different countries, just depending on their economic situation, their dependence on the local oil and gas sector and other things.
Graham, thank you very much for this. Really appreciate it.
Okay, you're welcome.